people like Eddie Cochran and Gene Vincent and those guys, because they laid the foundations, and the Beatles even acknowledged it, you know. So,
but great songs in three chords.
Yeah, three chord trick.
Yeah,
I'm still trying to master it.
Yeah. I mean, it is difficult to write a song that's so brilliant yet so simple in three chords. I mean, it looks easy. It's like trying to write a children's story. It looks easy, but it's not easy.
Which order are they in?
Yeah.
ADG.
Yeah. ADG. And not much lead guitar. Just that. Just the riff.
That's what's so good about punk.
Yeah.
Because it's all like three chord tricks and and everybody was like, all these guys that have been, you know, earning millions and millions of pounds over 30 years, all of a sudden we're like, punk, punk, what is it? It's a demon. It was just like kids saying, we want to make a noise, we want to be in a band, and it was like three chords and whatever else went with it. And I loved the attitude of it all, but I wouldn't say I like the melodies of it all, but I'm just being honest, you know. But some great punk records, three chords, maybe four.
Let's have a look at the man who made that three-chord trick work early on. See what all the fuss was about. This is Eddie Cochran, and Come On Everybody. Eddie, to me, was the guitar always looked enormous when you saw him to be a big Gretsch guitar. Yeah,
he's probably a dwarf.
He's really 4'11" with a normal guitar. And another great favourite of yours, one of the Black Soul singers, James Brown, Godfather of Soul.
James Brown, I saw when I was 15 at the Walthamstow Granada, and it blew my mind. There was like five little white boys, love affair, well, soul survivors. And we're all sitting in this, you know, the Granada, and we're like, and this guy just come on with the capes and everything else, and the two drummers and the big brass and the guy that led the band, and which I just thought, that's the benchmark. That's what I've got to do. I have got to be as good as that. Mm. And I tried. I really did try.
He was a showman, though, wasn't he? He was
fantastic.
Big showman.
But he was also a good singer when he was younger. Oh, I mean, a lot, you know, when he got into all the other sort of funky stuff, I kind of lost a bit of interest, to be honest with you, but his early stuff just I think's fantastic.
Hey, one of those, that did it for me was It's a Man's 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 World.
Yeah, wonderful, absolutely wonderful song.
Chris, the one you've chosen is Please, 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 another great track. What was it about this track that actually?
It's just got a lot of soul in it, it's got a lot of feeling, it's got a lot of emotion. It's just soul music, it's just nails it, bang, that's it.
James Brown on Vintage TV, and Please, 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 Steve Ellis, another choice, another good choice as well. There are so many great soul songs like that, you must be tempted to think, I'll have a go at that one, I'd like to record that, but will I do it as much justice as James Brown?
Would I? No, there's some things are sacred, and I think you've got to leave. There's some songs you just leave alone, because they cannot be bettered. It don't matter what you can't do them justice. Leave them alone. There's a million songs.
What is the ultimate song that you would not touch? If there was one song you just wouldn't go anywhere near, what would it be?
Oh, I don't know. I think about
what, Otis Redding song? Or
oh, I see, like that.
No, just one song that you go...
I thought you meant the bad song.
No, not a bad song. A great song. That is so good. You know, I know you wouldn't touch the Birdie song. It's just so good, you go, wouldn't even go near it.
That's How Strong My Love Is, Otis Redding.
Oh, yeah.
I wouldn't touch it. Wouldn't go near it. I couldn't. Forget about it. I was
way up there. And yet, it has been covered. I mean, bands like The In Crowd, Keith Westwood's The In Crowd, they did it, but it was a weakened version.
It's just
of it.
Stuff you cannot. There's hallowed ground. Yeah. It's like me going, I know what I do. Strawberry Fields Forever. Don't think so. It's not going to work.
However, talking about the Beatles and other great UK bands, you've picked The Who as one of your favourites. But you and Roger Daltrey go back, and you and Keith Moon have had a night or two together, haven't you?
Yeah, oh yeah.
But a great talent. I mean, Townsend, great writing talent.
Fantastic
the Ox, John and Whistle, great bass player. Keith, innovative drummer. Roger, great singer. I mean, they almost couldn't go wrong.
Well, the thing was that because me and Roger were pals, when I left the band, I moved. He had like an annex cottage next to his house, and he said, come down here and write some songs. So I went down to Sussex, and I had a cottage next door to his house, massive house, and I had a cottage. So he said, just do what you want, write your songs, get a band together. When Who were playing, this is around One Get Fooled Again, Who's Next, he'd say, oi, do you want to come and see us tonight? Because he's my mate. So I go, no, I can't tonight, I've got a rehearsal or something. But I saw The Who so many times when it was Keith, John, Pete and Rog in their prime. That's the best band, the best rock band for me, and I'm biased because Roger's my mate.
But, and the loudest.
That's why they're all deaf. Yeah. But I mean, for me, they're like the best rock and roll band ever. I never did see Zeppelin, so I have to say I never did see Zeppelin live, which I don't know why, but I never did. But The Who, when they brought out Who's Next, were just awesome.
Yeah, they did move with the times as well. By the time we got to Quadrophenia, backtracking to one of the tracks you picked, the early ones, Any Whiny, Howdy, Where, Can't Explain. Mm. I mean, Pictures of Lily, they just hit you between the eyes. Yeah. They were pop, but they were pop with
trick.
A punch.
Yeah. 3 minute trick. Townsend was writing, you know, 3 minute pop songs that were top of his game. They were fantastic. And he says in interviews, you know, that's how I was feeling at the time. But then you had a whole generation, excuse the pun, of mods that all latching onto this, all sort of going, got feelings, I can't explain, you know. Oh, yeah, I know what he means.
OK, let's take a look at him. Who on Vintage TV and Can't Explain, a choice on my Vintage of Steve Ellis. I mean, not only punchy three good, but it's just 2 minutes of pure energy, isn't it? Pure energy.
Yeah. Well, you've got Mooney thrashing with both hands. Very unusual drummer.
Oh, unusual style. But he used to hold his sticks like that.
Yeah, he was mucking about.
Manic look in his eye.
He was always mucking about.
Now, you've been working lately with the new Amen Corner. You were asked at one point to go and sing with the original Amen Corner. But seeing the new band, I mean, they're really pumping.
I got a fond, big place for Andy and the boys because at the time, it was in the papers, there was all this kind of like face of 68 rubbish, you know. And I remember doing a photo session with Andy, me, Francis Rossi, and Peter Frampton.
Yeah.
And it was like, you know, these are the players of this year, you know. And it was like, but it was never any of that, really. It was just.
But they used to do
fun.
That, didn't they?
Yeah, yeah.
All the magazines, the jackets,
yeah,
the
jacket
up,
but they'd all jacket up, so like try and make us, you know, Aiming Corner versus Love Affair. And we played Paisley Ice Rink with Gino, funnily enough. So it's Gino Washington, us, and Amy in Corner. 3,000 people, Paisley Ice Rink, and knocked it down now. Best gig in the world in the country then. It was better than Wembley. It was just brilliant. And I just really sort of got fond memories of those times, especially those gigs with the Amen boys. And I mean, Blue ended up with the Bee Gees and Dennis, and you know, they're all lovely people.
And you're still out there doing it as well, which is great. You've got the new album out, 10 Commitments, which is fantastic.
Thank you.
And good to ramble through some of your favourite songs. We could probably sit here for hours and pick hundreds of them, really, couldn't we? But anyway, Steve, as always, mate, absolutely fantastic. No, and we'll go out with Amen Corner. And one of their classics, Paradise Is Half As Nice. Is that, that's a good one, isn't it?
Yeah, by Andy Fur of Hello Records, please.
Good stuff. We'll do it again soon on My Vintage. You've been watching My Vintage with Steve Ellis and some of his great choices. Eddie Cochran, The Who, James Brown, and here they come. Amen Corner, If Paradise Is Half As Nice.